All right, Genesis is where we are, chapter 47. We're getting to the end of this book. Some of y'all are hanging in with me, seeing if I'm ever going to finish it. Lord willing, we'll do it. We'll see. Not tonight, though. Hey, Genesis 47, we're getting to the end of the Joseph narrative, closer and closer to the end of the story. And last week in chapter 46, we saw Jacob and all the brothers and their kids and their wives head into Egypt. So they've made their exodus from Canaan into the land of Egypt, where they will be for about 430 years. And remember, in chapter 46, Joseph gives them all this important advice and instruction. He goes to Goshen, this land of Goshen, where they've come and settled. He says, when you meet with Pharaoh, tell him you're anybody remember? A shepherd. That's right. You're a shepherd. If he asks you what you do, you say you're a shepherd. If he asks you what your father did, you tell him, shepherd. Shepherd, shepherd. You got it. You're a shepherd. Okay, so that's going to come into play tonight as we see him finally meet up with Pharaoh and some of his brothers and his father. Now, just to kind of recap, because I think it's important as we see kind of the result of some of this stuff. Remember Joseph's life. Joseph sold into slavery at the age of 17 years old by his older brothers. He lands in a guy named Potiphar's house. And in Potiphar's house, he becomes the chief steward, the house manager, in charge of everything. And Potiphar had to worry about nothing. But Potiphar's wife, she was, you know, kind of a desperate housewife, if you will. Okay, so she was after Joseph physically and would proposition him over and over again. And over and over, he'd tell her, no, it's not right to God, it's not right to Potiphar, I'm not going to do it. Until finally one day she seizes her opportunity. It's just the two of them in the house. She grabs a hold of him and he runs out with his garment left in her hand. And she uses that garment to make an accusation against him to Potiphar that he tried to rape her. He lands then in jail, and he's in prison for a number of years. It's in prison he meets a cupbearer and a baker that were part of Pharaoh's court. Pharaoh's cupbearer and Pharaoh's baker, and these two men are troubled by dreams. Joseph interprets these dreams. For one of them, it's going to be, you'll be restored to your high position. For the other one, it's your head is going to be lifted off of your head. So you'll be lifted back up and your head will be lifted off of your shoulders. And so those things come true. The cupbearer is restored, but he forgets about Joseph. 2 years go by. Then Pharaoh has a dream. And in the dream, the concerning part about the dream is these cows would come up out of the Nile River and they would be fat cows and they'd be devoured by skinny cows. And then you had heads of grain and he didn't know what all this meant. And the cupbearer said, oh yeah, I know a guy. He's in prison. Let me go get him. And he brings him in. And Joseph interprets these dreams for Pharaoh. They mean the same thing. And this is what the dreams meant. There was going to be 7 years of bountiful harvest in the land of Egypt. Record-setting years of harvest. But then after that, there would be a horrible famine for 7 years. And the famine for 7 years would be so terrible that it would completely wipe out even the memory of those 7 years of plentiful harvest. And so it sounds like to Pharaoh that Joseph knows what he's talking about. So he says, okay, you're going to be the guy. You're going to be in charge. Joseph says, you need to put one guy in charge. He's got to store up the grain for when the famine hits. Pharaoh says, okay, you're the guy. So he literally goes from a prisoner in the cell to the prime minister in the palace. Second in charge, only is he subject to Pharaoh in the whole land of Egypt. The 7 years of plenty happen. They store up all the grain. And then the terrible, desperate famine hits after that. And people start coming to Egypt more and more to get this food that they've stored up, including Joseph's brothers, the ones who sold him into slavery. And he does a little experiment with them, a little back and forth. He kind of messes with them a little bit, but the purpose is to figure out if they're still the same guys that sold him into slavery or not. And are they treating his little brother Benjamin the way they treated him? He determines they've changed, reveals himself to them, says, go back to Canaan, get my father, get everything you can, come here, and I'll take care of you in Egypt. So I recap all that because tonight we see all that come to fruition. Here's what it says in verse 1, chapter 47, verse 1. So Joseph went and informed Pharaoh, "My father and my brothers with their flocks and herds and all that they own have come from the land of Canaan and are now in the land of Goshen." Remember, Goshen is part of the Nile River Delta. It's the most lush land in Egypt. Verse 2, he says, "He took five of his brothers and presented them to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh asked his brothers, 'What is your occupation?' They said to Pharaoh, 'Your servants, both we and our fathers, are shepherds.' And they said to Pharaoh, 'We have come to stay in the land for a little while because there is no grazing land for your servants' sheep, since the famine in the land of Canaan has been severe. So now, please let your servant settle in the land of Goshen.' Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, 'Now that your father and brothers have come to you, the land of Egypt is open before you. Settle your father and brothers in the best part of the land. They can live in the land of Goshen. If you know any capable men among them, put them in charge of my livestock.'" So, first of all, the bros go to Pharaoh, and he just picks five of them. He just picks five of the brothers. Doesn't say which five. You know, there's 11 other than him. And so it doesn't really matter which five, but it just seems really intentional that he takes five. And you just, if you just think about all the things that Joseph is doing here, it just seems really strategic. Okay, right? He doesn't take all the brothers. He takes only five of them. Now, he doesn't want to overwhelm Pharaoh. He just wants to represent his family. He doesn't want to communicate to Pharaoh that this giant horde of people is moving into your country and they're going to reproduce like rabbits, which is what's going to happen. He just says, "Look, here's my family. Here's some of my brothers." And then he tells them, you know, remember, when he asks, "You're shepherds." And what do? Pharaoh, first thing, "What's your profession?" They don't say, "We're soldiers who could help mount a revolt one day." He doesn't say, we're politicians, because nobody likes politicians. No, I'm kidding. I'm just kidding. He doesn't say something like this, like, we're thieves. You know, we're traveling thieves. We just steal stuff. You know, he doesn't say anything like that. He said, "We're shepherds. We're not a threat. All we want to do is raise our sheep and raise our kids and raise our family. That's all we want." And so to pose no threat to Pharaoh and his dynasty, he says he takes five of them, and they're just shepherds. That's all they are. And once again, this is all coached, orchestrated, and prepared by Joseph. You see his wisdom throughout that. You see his leadership, his intentionality. This is how Joseph did things. He did things well. He didn't just stumble into things, right? He had a plan. He executed the plan. This is how Joseph lived his life. That's why he was so successful in the service to Potiphar, in the service to Pharaoh, in the service to the prison warden, because he was so thorough with things. Pharaoh says, "Okay, y'all are shepherds. Great. Y'all can have the land of Goshen." Well, Joseph just told him, "Hey, look, my family's all in Goshen," okay? Which is, by the way, the best land. And that's where they've settled. And I've brought these guys in here to see you. And the brothers ask for Goshen, and Pharaoh gives them Goshen. And Goshen is a place where it seems where Pharaoh has his livestock as well, because he says, "Listen, you can have the land, and if any of your brothers among you are capable men, put them in charge of my livestock as well." So Pharaoh has seen how capable Joseph is. He's seen that when Joseph puts his hand to something, it succeeds. So maybe he's hoping that his brothers will be blessed that way as well. Or at least he trusts Joseph to know whether his brothers are blessed like that or not. "Put them in charge of my livestock as well." So they're going to be in charge of the Pharaoh's livestock. That's an important job. Probably pays good. So that's good for them. And then next we see, after the brothers go before Pharaoh, now Jacob goes before Pharaoh. So Jacob himself, the patriarch here, is going to appear before Pharaoh. And here's what it says, verse 7. "Joseph then brought his father, Jacob, and presented him to Pharaoh. And Jacob blessed Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Jacob, 'How many years have you lived?' And Jacob said to Pharaoh, 'My pilgrimage has lasted 130 years. My years have been few and hard, and they have not reached the years of my fathers during their pilgrimages.' So Jacob blessed Pharaoh and departed from Pharaoh's presence." It's an interesting encounter. A few things stick out to me about that encounter. Number one, it says that Jacob blessed Pharaoh. Now, this is a ungodly Gentile leader. He worshiped the sun. He worshiped all these foreign made-up gods. And yet Jacob still blesses the Pharaoh. That's interesting. He blesses him twice. Blesses him when he comes, and he blesses him when he leaves. And Pharaoh seems to accept this blessing, which is usually kind of a sign of submission, maybe because Jacob's age was obviously a lot more than Pharaoh's. But it just seems interesting to me that he would bless this ungodly leader. But then you think about it, you know, God blesses some ungodly leaders throughout the scriptures, right? Including this guy, who we'll read about in just a minute. He's going to be thoroughly blessed by God. But you also think about even Nebuchadnezzar and others. And so it also occurs to me that, you know, we're supposed to be a blessing to people, aren't we? I mean, when people are around us, they're supposed to be blessed because of us. And so maybe Jacob epitomizes that by blessing Pharaoh. And then secondly, what appeals to me about this is that the first thing he asks, Pharaoh asks Jacob how old he is. Now doesn't he know that's not polite? Pharaoh asks, how many years have you lived? It's a little more obscure in the Hebrew. Like, how many days have been in the years of your life is kind of how that reads. And then Jacob's answer is also a little bit strange, isn't it? He says this, first of all, he says, my pilgrimage has lasted 130 years. This is how he describes those years. He says they've been few and hard. Literally, and your translation, if it's different than mine, literally says evil, hard and evil. That's what it says. Few and evil. So, here's what I like about that. He says pilgrimage. He doesn't say my life. He's advanced enough in years that he sees the end approaching, and has already come to the realization that many of us have not yet come to, and that is this truth that we are just passing through this life. You know, usually when somebody dies, what do we say? They passed. The truth is, when we live, we're just passing. The word here could also be translated sojourn. It means this. It means to leave home on a journey for which you will eventually return home. And that's Jacob's idea. This journey that I'm on has been difficult, and it hasn't been very long, but I'm going to go back home one day. I'm just here for a little while, and then it'll be gone, then it'll be over. I'm not home yet. I'm just passing through, and that needs to be our mentality as well. And can I make an application for us on that? Can you do me a favor? Can you try to remember that mentality in November? Not during deer season. During that election that's coming up that you maybe hear something about every once in a while. And as you see our country disappoint you sometimes, and you see the state of this nation that we all love as Americans, it's heartbreaking. And you just see these things that are going on, and you're like, do people really think that is okay? Have they lost their minds? Remember, this isn't home. And we love it. We care about our country, but this isn't home. We are just passing through. It's temporary at best. In Hebrews chapter 11, you know, it talks about the great heroes of faith, the Hall of Fame of faith. Here's how it describes them in verse 13. These all died in faith, although they had not received the things that were promised, but they saw them from a distance, greeted them, and confessed that they were foreigners and temporary residents on the earth. Now those who say such things make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they are thinking about where they came from, they would have had opportunity to return. And so the author of the book of Hebrews says that the patriarchs and these heroes of the faith had this mentality. that I'm on a pilgrimage, I'm on a journey, I'm not here forever. And depending on your age and depending on your health, you might know that more and more clearly. Because things start to break and break down. And you're reminded by the feebleness of our existence that it ain't going to last forever. It's just going to last a little while. It's also interesting to me that he describes his days as, first of all, few. I don't think any of us would describe 130 years as just a few years of life. That seems like a long one to us. But he says in comparison to his fathers, his ancestors, he has not reached the age of the number of years that they had. And that's true. So his grandfather, Abraham, had 185 years. Isaac, his father, 175 years. And his great-grandfather, Terah, had 205 years. So we know Jacob's going to live 147 years. He's 130 right here. He's going to live 17 years in the land of Egypt before he dies. And so, yes, relatively speaking, to the comparison to the age of his fathers, he doesn't live very long. He describes those years as evil or hard, difficult, painful, which sounds kind of ungrateful to me. It sounds kind of like a little bit of a Debbie Downer, you know? How's your life been? Awful? How's yours? You know, that's kind of the vibe I get when I read it. But I listened to J. Vernon McGee. Y'all know J. Vernon McGee? Remember J. Vernon through the Bible? J. Vernon and me? It's all on YouTube. You can listen to everything he's ever said on YouTube, I think. And I wanted his perspective on some of this, and I listened, and his perspective was that he's actually not being ungrateful, he's being humble. What old J. Vernon McGee said, he says he doesn't brag about the things he's done in his life, doesn't brag about his big family and all of his children, all of his sons, doesn't brag about how he got one over on his brother Esau or how he escaped the clutches of his father-in-law Laban. No, he's actually being humble. He's saying that my days have been difficult, they've been hard, but I'm not home yet, but I'm going home, it's okay. That's what J. Vernon McGee says. Perhaps, though, he's talking about his life events, and you think about the things that he experienced in his life, he's had a difficult life. I mean, at a young age, because of his own decisions, he had to flee his homeland to never see his mother again, because his twin brother Esau was going to kill him. He had to go to live with his father-in-law, who became his father-in-law, Laban, his uncle at the time, becomes his father-in-law, Laban, and he works, remember, 7 years for a wife? And what happens? The old switcheroo, right at the end, right on his wedding night, that's right, he gets Leah. He has to work another 7 years to get Rachel. Then he labors and toils. He's taken advantage of by his father-in-law Laban until he finally just escapes in the middle of the night. But he's tracked down by Laban, his father-in-law, who I think was planning to kill him. And I think that because God appears to Laban and stops him, says, don't you lay a hand on Jacob. So I think that means that Laban intended to kill him and take his daughters back and all of his stuff back. Then he loses Rachel while she's giving birth to Benjamin, his beloved wife. And then, at the age of 17 years old, Joseph is taken by his brother, sold into slavery, but he believes he's been killed. So yeah, he's had a hard life. He's had a tough life, but it's almost over. And so, this is what he says to him. It's been few, it's been hard, but it's just a pilgrimage. And then, if you kind of continue here, let's see, verse 11. Then Joseph, look at 11 and 12. Then Joseph settled his father and brothers in the land of Egypt, and he gave them property in the best part of the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded. And Joseph provided his father, his brothers, and all of his father's family with food for their dependents. Okay, so verse 11 and 12, you see Joseph save his family. I mean, this is the actual physical, this is the act of it. We knew it was coming. Here he's going to save them, provide for them, take care of them. They settle in the land of Ramses, which that word might stick out to you. That's the land of Goshen. Remember, Moses wrote the book of Genesis. At this point in Joseph's life, Ramses hasn't been born yet. It's Ramses the second who will be the Pharaoh when the Israelites make their exodus out of Egypt. But this was the home, this area of Goshen was the home of the residents of Ramses the first. And so, you know, Moses is writing to his audience who wouldn't know the name of Goshen. So he throws in this little reference to kind of a modern time at his point, Ramses. That's the area of Goshen. And this is it. Joseph takes care of him. He gets them the best land, in Egypt. He provides for their food, for his father, his brothers, all their kids, all the dependents. They have all the food that they're going to need, going to provide for them in every way. And why was Joseph able to do that? Suffering. Right? If he didn't get sold into slavery, if he didn't get falsely accused in Potiphar's house, if he didn't get thrown into prison, he would not be in this position to take care of his family. He had to endure all the suffering and be faithful through it, certainly. He had to have God's wisdom to know the plan, to put it into place. But he's able to do this because God perfectly positioned him to do so. But you know how he did that? Through suffering. He had to endure a lot. He had to endure a lot more than most of us have to endure. And yet we might be tempted to question God's purpose, question God's plan. We might be tempted to say, why me? This isn't fair. I don't deserve this. And yet it's just because of the suffering that he's able to get to this verse 11 and 12. He's going to save his family from starvation. He's going to get them set up with the best land in Egypt and all the food they need in the middle of a desperate famine. But it was hard to get to this point. Really, really hard. But notice that. They've got the best land. They got all the food they need. You see God blessing them through Joseph and through this position he's put Joseph in. This is a desperate famine. In just a minute, you'll see how desperate this famine really is. This is a terrible famine, worst kind of famine you can imagine. People are starving to death, undoubtedly, and yet his family has just gotten awesome land and all the food they need. This is God's blessing in the middle of a famine, God taking care of his people, Israel. Now, verse 13, we kind of leave the family for just a minute, and we're going to see the administration of Joseph's care for people and the administration of the grain. So all these people are going to come to Joseph for food, remember, and Egypt is going to get exceedingly wealthy. Here's what it says, verse 13, but there was no food in the entire region, for the famine was very severe. The land of Egypt and the land of Canaan were exhausted by the famine. And Joseph collected all the silver to be found in the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan in exchange for the grain they were purchasing. And he brought silver to Pharaoh's palace. When the silver from the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan was gone, all the Egyptians came to Joseph and said, give us food. Why should we die here in front of you? The silver is gone. And so, at this point, and we're not even halfway through this narrative right here, all the money of all the people in Egypt, we're out of money. We're starving to death, and we've given you all of our money already. So just imagine how much silver there was in Egypt, probably a lot. Probably a lot in the land of Canaan. And now Pharaoh, through Joseph, has collected all of it. Can you imagine getting to a point where, like, listen, there's no more money in the whole country. You have all the money. And we still are starving to death. But notice this in verse 14. It says, Joseph collected all the silver to be found in the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan in exchange for the grain they were purchasing. And he brought the silver where? To Pharaoh's palace. All that money, you know? No accountability. You can't count grain. I mean, you could weigh it. All that silver rolling in, you know? Pharaoh wouldn't notice. if a little bit went missing. But it says he didn't take any of it into Joseph's palace, did he? He took it all to Pharaoh's palace. See, Joseph is as trustworthy with Pharaoh's silver as he was with Potiphar's wife. Joseph could be trusted when people were watching and when people were not watching. And that, my friends, is called integrity. And we see it over and over and over. And you just skim over this verse, but understand, listen, it'd be so easy to think this. If you were Joseph, Pharaoh is getting rich off of my idea and my plan. He wouldn't even have known about this famine if it wasn't for me. He'd be starving just like the rest of them if it wasn't for what I did. So certainly I deserve to take a little extra for me. But it wasn't Joseph's plan, was it? It wasn't Joseph's idea, was it? It was God. And Joseph was humble enough to understand that. That he was where he was, and he was able to do what he was able to do because God had blessed him. God had given him the wisdom. God had given him that opportunity. And so when he got this silver, he takes it all right into Pharaoh's palace. Verse 16, they're out of money. We ain't got nothing left. We got nothing to give you. We're going to die of starvation. So Joseph says, give me your livestock. Since the silver is gone, I'll give you food in exchange for your livestock. So they brought their livestock to Joseph, and he gave them food in exchange for the horses, the flocks of sheep, the herd of cattle, and the donkeys. That year he provided them with food in exchange for all their livestock. By the way, that word right there, or you saw it, horses, that's the first mention of horses in the Bible. Genesis chapter 47. And they're Egyptian horses, which is interesting. That comes into play a little bit later on. Deuteronomy tells the kings of Israel not to acquire for themselves Egyptian horses. Don't send the people back to get Egyptian horses. Egypt must have been known for their horses. And then we find out that Solomon acquires a whole bunch of Egyptian horses, just right contrary to God's word in Deuteronomy. But that's the first mention of horses, and look at that, they're Egyptian horses. And so they trade their livestock. There's no more food. I mean, there's no more money. There's no more food. We got these animals. He says, okay, I'll take all the livestock. Verse 18, when that year was over, they came to the next year and said to him, we cannot hide from our Lord. The silver is gone. All the livestock now belongs to our Lord. There is nothing left for our Lord except our bodies and our land. Why should we die here in front of you, both us and our land? Buy us and our land in exchange for food. Then we, with our land, will become Pharaoh's slaves. Give us seed that we can live and not die, and so the land won't become desolate. In this way, Joseph acquired all the land in Egypt for Pharaoh, because every Egyptian sold his field since the famine was so severe for them. The land became Pharaoh's, and Joseph moved the people into cities from one end of Egypt to the other. The only land he did not acquire belonged to the priests, for they had an allowance from Pharaoh. They ate from the allowance that Pharaoh gave them. Therefore, they did not need to sell their land. Joseph said to the people, understand, today I have acquired you and your land for Pharaoh. Here is seed for you. Sow it in the land. The harvest, you are to give a fifth of it to Pharaoh, and four-fifths will be yours as seed for the field and as food for yourselves, your household, and your dependents. Verse 25 says, you have saved our lives, they said. We have found favor with our Lord and will be Pharaoh's slaves. So Joseph made it a law, still in effect today in the land of Egypt, that a fifth of the produce belonged to Pharaoh. Only the priest's land does not belong to Pharaoh. And so he got all the livestock. He got all the horses. He got all the cattle. And then they come back to him the next year and say, listen, we're out of money. We're out of livestock. And once again, we are out of food. There's nothing else we can sell you. All we have is the land we live on and our bodies. So buy the land and buy us. So they offer themselves into slavery. They sell themselves into slavery so that they don't starve to death. And Joseph takes the deal. He acquires all the land in Egypt. It all becomes Pharaoh's land, except for the priests. They had an allowance from Pharaoh. They had government-subsidized religion in Egypt. And so they get to keep their land because they don't need the money. But everybody else, all the other land, becomes Pharaoh's. And the people become Pharaoh's servants, Pharaoh's slaves. They belong to Pharaoh as well. And Joseph institutes this law of 1/5 or 20%. So you grow the crops. I'll give you the seed. You grow the crops, and you give us back to Pharaoh a fifth. You keep 4/5, and we take 1/5, 20%. Does that sound harsh? How many of you wish you could pay 20% taxes? Hey, wouldn't that be nice? We pay way more than that, don't we? We got sales tax, got income tax, we got property tax, and inheritance tax. So we tax you to death, then we tax you once you're dead, right? We just tax you all the way around. And so he sets that up. And how do the people respond? They're overjoyed. They're so excited because they're not going to starve to death. They're desperate. Interestingly, this is interesting to me anyways, as I read this, as I think about this, you know, at least a couple of times in modern history, communists have used famines to accomplish almost the exact same thing that happens and takes place here. In China and in Russia, famine drives people to allow communism to take over, which communism, essentially, the state owns what? All the land and the people of the land. They all belong to the state. And so that takes place here. During desperate times, government centralizes and gets stronger. And that's what you see demonstrated really vividly here for us. So Joseph gives them the seed. They're going to grow. He knows the famine's almost over. So it's about time to plant. So he's going to give them the seed. They're going to start planting. Things are going to get better. Now, here's a few questions to ask ourselves. Number one, Joseph's been criticized here. Is this a cruel thing to do for Joseph? Does Joseph do something bad here? I mean, he enslaves all these people. That sounds rough. Well, let's think about it a little bit differently. First of all, whose idea was it? It was the people's idea. They asked him to do it. Also, his actions do save all of their lives. So that's good. There's also a couple of just real practical things, you know, like the law of supply and demand, right? They needed food and he had it. And also, you think about it, you know, it's Joseph's job to represent Pharaoh. And so that's his job. And so Joseph does a good job when he's in charge. So Joseph really does a great job for Pharaoh, and Pharaoh gets a ton and ton and ton of money, heaps of money and property and everything. And I think they call that a fiduciary responsibility. Joseph had a responsibility to look out for the best interests of Pharaoh as his representative. So he does that. Joseph's a good worker. Now the next question you ask is, why does Pharaoh get so blessed? Why does this ungodly Gentile leader get so much money, so much property, all the livestock? Why does God bless the Pharaoh of Egypt? Yeah, I mean, I think the answer is because the Pharaoh blesses Israel. Doesn't he? I mean, this Pharaoh gives Israel all the land they're going to need and all the food they're going to need and gives them the best. This Pharaoh blesses Israel, and so God blesses him. Another Pharaoh is going to come along, and he's going to curse Israel. And what's God going to do? God's going to curse him through some plagues. So God responds to the way you treat his people. He says that already to Abraham. The Abrahamic covenant was, I'll bless those who bless you, and I'll curse those who curse you. And that's the case. And I think that's still the case today, by the way, for the Israelites, for God's people. And so we finally see it happen. It finally comes to fruition. We've been leading up to this moment for a couple of weeks, and it finally takes place. Joseph saves his people. Joseph provides for them, gives them everything they're going to need. Not because of anything they did on their own. They did everything to not deserve this, and yet they're still blessed by Joseph, ultimately by God, putting Joseph in the position to do that. And so it's no surprise that a lot of people make a correlation there. They say Joseph is a Jesus-like or a Christ-like figure, a type of Christ in the Old Testament, because he provides for, through suffering, his people and their every need. And that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus left the comfort of heaven and came to earth and endured all the evil treatment that man could possibly throw at him. He was laughed at. He was spat upon. He was beaten. They put a crown of thorn on his head. And then they hung him on a cross. And he died completely, 100% dead. He experienced a brutal and painful death. And then 3 days later, he came back. He came back from the dead, overcoming the power of sin and death once and for all, so that he could make provision for our sins, for all the things that you've done wrong, that I've done wrong in our lives. Because the truth is, our days have been few and they have been evil. We've committed evil. We've done evil things. And on our best day, on our very, very best day, we are sinners saved by the grace of God through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And if you need more information about that, how you can have a relationship with Jesus because of his sacrificial death on the cross, please talk to me anytime. Would love to share more about that with you.